الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Dear brothers and sisters in Iman, yesterday we spoke about the month of Ramadan, the virtues and the importance of month of Ramadan, and how should we conduct ourselves during the month of Ramadan, how should we fast, how should we make sure that our fast is the proper fast and the full fast, or fast in its entirety. And today I would like to talk about Quran, because there is a very close connection between Ramadan and Quran. We always read this Surah Qadr, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. Matter of fact, this Surah Qadr is one of the most recommended surahs to recite in our wajib or daily prayers. According to some ulama, some maraje taqleed, they believe that one should recite this Suratul Qadr in first rak'at in every daily prayer, and Surah Qul Huwallahu Ahad in the second rak'at. So that when they say, they mean actually if you want to get the maximum thawab, then these two surahs are highly recommended. Surah Qadr in first rakat and Surah Qul Huwallah in the second rakat. But we are allowed to recite the other surahs also, as long as we recite these two surahs often. So the main purpose is that we keep reciting these two surahs for the high importance of the message conveyed in these surahs. Month of Ramadan is month of Quran. It is a month which is particularly given a special identity of revelation of Quran. Shahru Ramadan allazi unzila fihi al-Quran. This is a month of Ramadan in which Quran was revealed as a guidance for mankind. Hudan lin-nas. Again, important message here is that Quran, of course, is supposed to be recited. It is supposed to be recited, but recitation is not the purpose. Recitation is only a mean and not the purpose. The purpose is hudan linnas. It is a guidance. And the purpose of revealing Quran was to make people seek guidance from this book and live with this book. But we cannot seek guidance until we read it, until we recite it. So that is why there is a high emphasis on recitation. But recitation is a mean and not the end. End is seeking guidance, seeking knowledge, seeking solutions, and seeking the directives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this particular book. So, keeping that in mind, today I will talk about the importance of Quran, importance of its recitations, and some adab about Quran, and some fiqhi issues and masail which are very important for us to know in relation with Quran. And this is just setting the stage. Yesterday we spoke about Ramadan. Today I am speaking about Quran. And tomorrow I will be talking about Dua, because this is a month of Dua also. The month of Dua, the month of Munajat. And actually, most of our Duas are in one way or the other, they are related to the month of Ramadan. So, after these three presentations, I will get into the theme which I have designed, alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, that is the theme of Islamic etiquettes, adab. Islamic etiquettes of all major areas of our life. As I said yesterday, we eat food. But we need to know what are the Islamic etiquettes of eating food, serving food, cooking food, and then eating food. There are certain adab which are taught by Prophet and A'imma alayhimu salatu wasalam to us. People learn these etiquettes of food or table manners in schools, and there are certain other places where people learn these adab, because in particularly in this modern society where half of the most important meetings take place on these dining tables. They invite you for lunch and then they want to have a meeting with you. They invite you for dinner and they want to have some important meeting with you. And they judge you and they assess you on the dining table, and they get some idea that what kind of person and what kind of personality you hold, and they want to see that how civilized you are and how well-mannered you are, and all those, so many things, people, they get the idea. But in Islam we are also taught the adab. They are known as adab-e-sufre or adab-ul-ma'ida. Ma'ida is a dining table. How should we serve? How should we take food? How should we enjoy the food? What is the dua to begin with? What is the dua at the end when we are done with the food? And then how to thank Allah and how to thank the one who has prepared it? And all those kind of, there are things. And then there are some directions about moderation about food and meaning so many things, whether we should avoid from eating something which is very hot, and we should be careful about eating the different kinds of food. So this is just one example. But then there are adab for buying libas and wearing libas, and what color and what kind of quality and what kind of libas, what are the characteristics of libas? Why should one wear libas, and then what is the purpose of libas? And then when we buy the libas, then when we put on, there is a dua. And then how can we make that dua that when we wear this libas, so we always enjoy good health and we enjoy the barakat and blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we remain safe from the evil eye and from all the bad happenings. Again, there are adab in each and every area of life, for children, for parents, for regular community members. There are adab for tijarat, for business, for butala, for study, for marriage, and for divorce or in every area of life. This is a whole Islamic lifestyle, Islamic civilization, adab. So inshallah we will get into that, but I thought in the very beginning, because this is the month of Ramadan, we should first have some discussion about fasting, some discussion about Quran, some discussion about dua for first 3 days, and then inshallah we get into that discussion. Recite a salawat. So brothers and sisters, Allah Himself says that this Ramadan is the month in which Quran was revealed. One clarification, no one should think that month of Ramadan is blessed or Mubarak or special because Quran was revealed in it. Many times we begin thinking like that month of Ramadan is holy, it is blessed because Quran was revealed in it, while it is otherwise. Actually, Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan because month of Ramadan was the most blessed time and the most blessed month. So Shahru Ramadan allazi unzila fihi al-Quran, or inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. Laylatul qadr was there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Laylatul Qadr for this particular work, or for this particular happening, which was the revelation of Quran, Nuzul Quran. So month of Ramadan was blessed from before. That is why even Torah was revealed in it. That was why even Injil was revealed in it. That is why even Zabur was revealed in it. That is why even those books of Hazrat Ibrahim were revealed in it. So month of Ramadan is blessed, is Mubarak. And one of the reasons that Quran was revealed in this month, because it was a blessed month. Quran, the word Quran is Arabic word and it is Masdar. It comes from the root qara'a. Qara'a, yaqra'u, qara'an wa qira'atan wa qur'anan. These are three masdars. Meaning, Quran is literally, if you want to translate, it is something which is being recited or which is supposed to be recited. It comes from recitation. So the nature of Quran, Quran was not a book written like any other books, then Quran would follow a different order. There are people who criticize Quran. They say, why there is a lot of repetition? Why there is not any particular order in Quran? When you read the Quran, any other book, you have the table of contents, then chapters and different order, and then you have some order in a book, which is written as a book. Quran was not sent as a book. Quran was sent as a script which people were supposed to recite. And through their daily recitations, they had to learn the information, and they had to learn the message. They need to get the message, and certain things will get emphasized over and over and over because they are reciting it. So the word Quran itself means recitation, or something which is being recited, or something which is supposed to be recited. So it is very important, my brothers and sisters, when we bring the copy of Quran to our home, to remember that this book is supposed to be recited. This is not supposed to be kept in shelves and saved just here and there, or only as a gift we are enjoying receiving and giving. No, this is something we are bringing home, and we need to know it is supposed to be recited. Recitation of Quran is very important. Let me share with you some of the ahadith which I have brought. First of all, The most important hadith on the subject is a famous hadith which most of you know by heart. This is the hadith of Prophet where he says, إِنِّي تَارِكُنْ فِيكُمُ الثَّقَلَيْنِ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَعِتْرَتِي أَهْلَ بَيْتِي مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدِي. Prophet says that I am leaving behind two very valuable things. One is the book of Allah, which is Quran, and my pure progeny, my Ahlul Bayt. These two valuable sources of guidance and leadership I am leaving behind. So people were of course worried, what will happen after Prophet? Prophet was the most important man for that community or for that society or for this faith community. And this most important man, when he will leave, what will happen? So Prophet is providing the answer. Prophet says, I am leaving, but I am leaving behind two most valuable things. One is Quran, the other one are Ahlul Bayt. If you remain in contact with these two and follow them, then I guarantee you that you will not go astray. لَن تَذِلُّ بَعْدِي. So the guarantee which we have from Prophet of not going to astray is basically vested in these two things. One is Kitab, the other is Ahlul Bayt. And we need to maintain our contact, our relation with these two. We need to know them, we need to understand them, and then we need to follow them. Kitab, of course, we need to learn how to recite. We need to read it often. We will see, we are recommended to recite it on daily basis. Recitation of Quran is not only the month of Ramadan. Month of Ramadan is a month that when we recite often or we recite much or we dedicate more time. As I mentioned yesterday, Prophet was used to recite the whole Quran in the 1 month of Ramadan. And then in the last year, he did twice. So, this month, yes, there are some special sawabs and rewards, but every day we are supposed to recite Quran. We need to recite, so we need to learn how to recite. Then recitation is a mean, it is not the purpose, then we need to understand the meaning. So either we need to learn Arabic or we need to get hold of a good translation which we can understand. Urdu, English, Farsi, any other language which we understand. So we need to have, and sometimes you need more than one translations at your access, because these translations are sometimes very wordy and not very clear. So maybe you are reading it and you don't get the meaning, you don't understand what is being said here. So it is good to look to the other translation, look to the third translation. 2, 3, 4 translations if you have at your disposal, then you will find out that what is being mentioned here. So that is the second stage of recitation of Quran, then knowing the meaning, then going deeper than that, which is tafsir. Prophet himself, one of his duties was to do the tafsir of Quran, which was bayan. The Quran Prophet was supposed to explain Quran. And people would come to the Prophet and they would say, Ya Rasulullah, you recited this ayat and I didn't understand what Allah wants by this ayat. What is the meaning? What is the purpose? What are the details involved? How to implement this? So people would come with these questions, and the job of Prophet was to explain. Later, this was the job of our A'imma, Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam, to explain to the people. And they were the mufassireen of Quran. That tafsir is very important for us, my brothers and sisters. That is not only for ulama. It should be at disposal of average community members also. Now, fortunately, the books of tafsir have been translated into many languages. In Urdu, we have tafaseer translated. In Farsi, there is a lot of literature available. In English, they have started also translating these tafaseer. We should try to bring those books, those tafaseer at home. And when we read, first we need to learn how to recite. Then we need to learn how to know the meanings and then get into the tafsiri details. Similarly about Ahlul Bayt, in the very beginning when we are very young, our mothers teach us the holy names, Panchtan Pak, and then 12 A'imma, Chaharda Ma'asumeen. So we learn these names, a list of names. But then later on, they tell us who was Imam Ali, who was Imam Hassan, who was Imam Hussain, and then we learn about the lives of Ahlul Bayt. Then we learn a little bit more details about certain incidents, about Mubahla, about Ghadir, about Karbala, about Fadak, about Kisa, Hadith-e-Kisa, and all these events over the time. So we need to learn more and more and more knowledge about Ahlul Bayt, and then again we need to learn their teachings and their directives, and then we need to follow. After knowing that what kind of life they lived and what they wanted from us. So that is the purpose, my brothers and sisters, that we need to familiarize ourselves with Quran and Ahlul Bayt. Then we need to practice on that. Now, there is a beautiful saying of our fourth Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam, where he says, لَوْ مَاتَ مَنْ بَيْنَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ لَمَسْتَوْحَشْتُ بَعْدَ أَنْ يَكُونَ الْقُرْآنُ مَائِي. Fourth Imam says that, God forbid, if this scenario happens, that everybody on this planet is wiped out. Everybody from Mashriq to Maghrib, Mata, died, wiped out. And I have one copy of Quran with me at my disposal. Imam says, I will never feel lonely on this whole planet. Nobody else is existing. Nobody else is available with whom I can sit, I can chat, I can talk, I can have company. Everybody would feel that, oh, I will be lonely, or I will be kind of depressed or something like that. Imam says, as long as I have copy of Quran with me, I have great company available to me, I will never feel lonely. So this itself, there is a message. Many of us who don't have much social life, who don't have many friends around, or our friends died, or our friends left, our friends moved, we become so much kind of like depressed, so much under stress, so much lonely. Our fourth Imam is telling us that instead of feeling lonely, the best companion for you is this word of God. Get the ons and company of Quran. And if you make Quran your companion, and if you read it, this is the companion which will make you free of need from any other companion. And you will never feel lonely. Matter of fact, when you will recite this, and then you can send the sawab of this to your those marhumin. Sometimes we are very much attached with our parents or siblings or our friends. And after their departure, of when they depart from this world for years and years, we don't feel that we are in a kind of right condition. We feel so much lonely and so much depressed. One way to come out from that is that take Quran as a companion and read Quran every time you get the chance, and send sawab, and also you will find the companion. Similar hadith comes from Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, where he says, Man anisa bitlawatul Quran لم توحشه مفارقة الإخوان. He who becomes anis or ma'anus, he who becomes familiar and takes companionship with Quran, لم توحشه مفارقة الإخوان. Leaving off his friends or brothers will not make him lonely or depressed, because he has a best companion, he has a best friend, and that is the Quran. When he recites, so he is enjoying actually talking to Quran or talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So because many of us, we have not developed that companionship with Quran, many of us will be right now maybe thinking that how come a very lively company of a friend, chatting and talking and telling jokes and enjoying, for example, a very sweet discussion with a friend, and then here is just reading a foreign text, a language which we don't know, and we're just reading that Arabic, struggling with this recitation, and then we are saying that this will make us free from that lively company of friends. The problem is because we have not become familiar with this text. This text is still ajnabi. It is still strange to us. Because hardly we recite, occasionally we recite, and we have not listened to those people that who recite it in most beautiful manner. We have not attended those gatherings where Quran was being recited and people were really enjoying being in those heavenly companies. It's the recitation of Quran, listening Quran, enjoying the recitation of Quran, my brothers and sisters, again is a taste which unfortunately most of us have not developed. It's good to have collection of those beautiful recitations at home, in our cars, on these iPods, wherever now you have all these devices, and listen to these recitations and enjoy listening these recitations. Allah give us tawfiq, and we should organize those kind of gatherings in our masajid and in our centers, invite those reciters that who recite Quran, and then we can listen to them. And then again, it is not only the recitation or art of recitation or just like a music. No, when we will read the meaning, alaykum salam, when we will inshallah familiarize ourselves with the contents of Quran, with the themes of Quran, with the message of Quran, with the teachings of Quran, we will begin enjoying the recitation of Quran. We will see many times that the question which we have in our mind and we are struggling with it and we don't find answer, the daily recitation will offer us sometime even those answers. Many times when we are feeling down, feeling helpless, and then we recite the story of Hazrat Nuh, we recite the story of Hazrat Ayyub, we recite the stories of those Anbiya like Hazrat Zakariya and Hazrat Yahya, and we see that how he is subjected to all the torture and all the bad language, abusive language. People were harassing these Anbiya, harassing these messengers, and then how these Anbiya and these Awliya survived. So we can identify ourselves many times with these themes and with these teachings of Quran, with these role models mentioned in Quran. But the problem is we don't recite Quran. Quran is not part of our daily life. That is the problem. Quran is only, as we say, either month of Ramadan or when somebody will die, people will sit down and do the Isale Sawab and then they will recite the Quran. It's only for Amwat. While Quran is not revealed for Amwat, it is Linnas and it is recite. It was revealed for guidance. Guidance is not for Amwat, guidance is for the living ones. If Quran is supposed to guide, how can you guide the dead? You can only guide those who are living, listening, hearing, and those who can take it. But the book, this book of livings has become a book of dead. So, these two ahadith, one from fourth Imam and one from Amirul Mu'mineen, explain that one has to take Quran as his companion, as his friend, and then read it. By the way, it is also highly recommended to stick with one copy of Quran for lifetime if you can, and take this copy very special to you. Always read from that copy. When you travel, take it with you. If you are going somewhere, and so it should be your companion. You get used to it, as people sometimes get used to with their tasbih or with their rings. They cannot go without this ring because they cannot see their finger without this one. They cannot go without this particular watch. They cannot go without this particular glasses. So similarly, this Quran, the copy of Quran should be your special copy. We have in the rulings of fiqh that when somebody dies and we talk about the inheritance, there are special rulings that who is going to inherit this special copy of Quran of the deceased. Because this is a very special thing. So this is a tabarruk which the eldest son takes as varasat or as inheritance of his father. Alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. This is for the eldest son. Because he is the one who is going to do the missed prayers and the fastings and hajj and everything on behalf of his father. So he has a certain portion in the varasat which Islamic Sharia gives, that these are the special items of the father and these are only for the eldest son. Similarly, our janamaz, our ulama, and you are familiar with the story of this Ayatollah Najafi Marashi, that he made special wasiyat that this piece of he had one piece of sajdaga from Karbala, Khak-e Shifa. So he made the wasiyat that bury this one with me in my grave, put it under my cheek, and even that handkerchief which he was used to hold in his hands when he was sitting in the majlis and he was crying and he was wiping his tears with, that put it in my coffin. So these things are, my brothers and sisters, these things are very special things. It's not today this is this copy of Quran, next day this copy of Quran, third day and this one. Yes, it is okay, but it's good to have your own special one. Stick with it. You will become ma'noos with it. You will fall in love with it. You will enjoy reciting it. So the whole idea is taking Quran as companion, as friend. Now see the next hadith of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. He uses the word Samir. Samir is a name also in our culture. Many brothers are brother Samir and many sisters are also sister Samiras. Anybody knows the meaning of Samir? Samir or Samira? Samir is actually your friend with whom you sit and enjoy your talk in the evenings or in the night. It was a culture. Still in Arabs, they have this culture of Ga'da, they call Ga'da, they sit down, all that. and sit at night, and they have shisha, and they have this coffee going on, and they have this tea going on, and they enjoy talking and talking and talking almost whole night. So these people are samir, because your good friends may not be available to you during the daytime because they are all working and they are all busy. But at night, now they can all gather at one place and go and have company with their real and true friends. And they enjoy each other's company and they talk to each other. So that is called Samir. Samira is your companion with whom you enjoy your talk or conversation during the night as a good company. Meaning your closest friend, in other words, your most sincere friend and the closest friend. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, لَيَكُنْ سَمِيرُكَ الْقُرْآنِ لَيَكُنْ سَمِيرُكَ الْقُرْآنِ. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, your Samir should be Quran. In the daytime, you were with people, you were with family, you were with friends, you were with colleagues, you were with all those other people, and you didn't have time. But at night, now you should have this companion and have Quran on your lap, and you should recite Quran and enjoy this conversation or this talk with Quran. A'imma alayhi salatu wa salam have great emphasis. There is a hadith of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam, where he says, what is wrong with these busy people? And he means the busy people of his time. He said, they always keep saying they are busy, they are busy, they are busy. Don't they have time to recite 50 ayat before going to bed? Then in one riwayat he says, don't they have time to recite at least 40 ayat before going to bed? Then there is a third hadith which he comes to the minimum number and he says, don't they have time to recite at least 10 ayat before going to bed? So the idea is that if we have excuses during the daytime, at night when we are done with dinner, when we are done with some of the other these routines, so we should sit down and enjoy this heavenly company of Quran. Reciting Quran, it should become a daily routine. Now I will refer to you, I don't have time here to read, but when you go back and if you have time, open Nahjul Balagha. In Nahjul Balagha, there is a khutbah of Amirul Mu'mineen, Fi Sifatul Muttaqeen. Amirul Mu'mineen, at the request of one of his companions, outlines all those characteristics of Muttaqeen. In that khutbah, Amirul Mu'mineen talks about Muttaqeen and he says, these are the people who get up in the middle of night, leave their warm bed, and they stand up in front of God, and what they do, they recite Quran. So recitation of Quran is something that which we are told that even at the middle of night we have to leave our bed and the comfort of bed and go and make wudu and recite Quran in those nawafils and the ibadat. So my brothers and sisters, this all time which I took in the to emphasize on this, to explain that recitation of Quran is not something very like kind of casual or very easy one or light one which we can take light. This is the job of the students of madrasa. This is the job of maulvis. This is the job of maulana. This is the job of the elderly. This is the job of someone who doesn't have anything to do. No, Quran is a book which is linnas. It is for mankind. It is a letter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to each one of us. And we need to read it and read it and read it. A according to hadith of Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, he says this is our contract. He says the Quran is our contract with our God. And every wise man would read the contract, whatever he has with others, and would read it again and again whenever he gets chance, instead of forgetting it. So this is our contract, and we need to read it. Then all of us, we complain that there are days when we are high and there are days when we are low, particularly with about our spirit, our faith, our strength of our iman. Sometimes we are feeling very strong in our iman, and sometimes we feel that really I have to push myself to go and do this 2 rakat wajib namaz, or I have to push myself to really go and do anything which is wajib. Feeling down. What should we do to strengthen our faith, to revive our faith? Amirul Mu'mineen says that what you need to do is Likahul Iman Tilawatul Quran. Likahul Iman Tilawatul Quran. If you feel that your iman is kind of dying down, getting weaker and weaker, so what you need to do is recite Quran. This recitation of Quran, Tilawatul Quran, will revive your faith. But if we do it on ongoing basis, my brothers and sisters, you can take some statistics. If you go in the community, if you see there are few individuals who recite Quran on daily basis, they are regular in reciting Quran, and they are doing it from years and years and years and years, you will see their faith, their practice, their spirit, their tawakkul totally different than those that who just do it on and off, or those who don't do it altogether. I have spent, because when we travel for these majalis or programs sometime, so people take us to their homes, and we stay with so many people, and then we have chance of reading their Quran, praying on their janamas. So I have come across with quite few those good brothers and sisters in community at large, that when I was given the copy of Quran, I felt that this Quran was being recited on daily basis and from decades. You could see wear marks, and then you see the writings and the margins and what you call highlighted ayat and the question marks and all that kind of things. So you see this Quran is being recited, and somewhere you go and you open the Quran, and even the pages are, you need to ask that, brother, can you give the kya kehte hai usko jo envelope kholta hai, letter opener, because you are the first one that who is going to now read this page. So sometime even people have difficult time to tell you where is the Qibla properly. They will, the husband is saying this side, the wife is saying this side, the children are telling, again everybody is guessing. So that shows that meaning what kind of this Muslim family is. So we need to have these things as routines, my brothers and sisters. The copy of Quran, the janamaz, the direction of Qibla, the sajdagah, the tasbih, all these kind of things. And then again, our daily routines. Likahul Iman Tilawatul Quran. Many times people ask this question, zikr, what zikr we should do? People are asking for tasbih. And people love to, if you tell them most difficult things or things which are not written anywhere, people enjoy and appreciate those things more because they are new. Oh, this is something I never heard. While the things which are true, they are always heard. The Quran is never new. The hadith of Prophet is never new. They are always there and everybody knows. But the tendency of a human being is that they are looking something totally different and new. Now the hadith which I am reading for you is answer to that. People would come to Imam Ali or to the Prophet and ask that what is the best zikr which we should do? Tasbih, any zikr, anything, tell us. And Qala Ali, afdalu zikr al-Qur'an. Afdalu zikr al-Qur'an. The best zikr if you want to enjoy, that is the Qur'an, the word of God. Word of God is afdalu zikr. And this every ayat of Qur'an is the ayat of Qur'an. So you can recite and you can take the benefit of that. People came and complained to the Prophet again about that we are not enjoying the spirit. We are feeling that our faith is getting weak. And sometimes we really feel very strong. Sometimes we have to really push ourselves and we don't feel that eagerly we are doing anything Islamic. Prophet says, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Inna Inna hazihil qulub latasda'u. These hearts get rusted. This is a hadith of Prophet. He says, hearts get rusted. Kama yasda'ul hadid, as the iron gets rusted. Loha, as it gets rusted, these hearts also get rusted. Qila, Fama jila'uha. People said, Ya Rasulullah, then how can we remove that rust from our hearts? How can we clean them? Is there anything? Qala dhikrul maut wa tilawatul Quran. Prophet says there are two things which can remove the rust from your heart. One is remembrance of death. The second is tilawatul Quran. If we can just imagine some time when we are in our big master bedroom, that there is going to be a day when I will be same dark, but there is no big room like this. It is going to be a small grave, not this comfortable bed. I will not enjoy this kind of pillow, this kind of comforter. I will not have this heating and cooling system working. It will be just a little piece of dust and I am in my grave and it is closed. I don't have even this liberty to sit up and stand and walk and go here and go there and feel for some moments that I am there, already there. This is the room. This room is grave. Now I cannot sit, I cannot stand, I cannot even come down from my bed forever. This is it. See what happens, the feelings. But we never even put ourselves in that situation. We don't want to introduce ourselves with this reality. The other thing is Tilawatul Quran. Tilawatul Quran enlightens the hearts. It revives the faith. It strengthens the spirit. So my brothers and sisters, the rewards of reciting Quran in this month, reciting one ayat in this month is equal to reciting the whole Quran in any other month. One of the reasons that Quran is divided into 30 paras. Have you ever thought about that? That why Quran is divided into these 30 sections? Sijuz, what they call. The 30 sections, the reasoning behind it, that everyone is going to read one juz on daily basis and finish the Quran every month. Quran was conveniently, otherwise this is not a division which Allah has revealed or the Jibreel had brought that. It was decided by the leadership of Muslims in way early time that in order to encourage people to recite Quran on daily basis, so people should read one juz of Quran every day. But those who are very busy, they can recite little less. But it should be daily. We put so much effort in teaching these young children at Sunday schools to learn Quran. For 2, 3, 4, 5 years, we struggle, they struggle, teachers struggle, mothers struggle, everybody. And this innocent child doesn't see anybody reading Quran from the adults at home. Never saw Quran on the lap of father, or never saw Quran on the lap of mother. Nobody is reciting it, nobody is making use of it. So this little child is being forced to learn it, but doesn't know why he or she is being forced to learn it while there is no use of it. So this child has to see on daily basis that this text is being recited, and mom is reciting, and dad is reciting, and grandpa is reciting, and grandma is reciting, and older brother is reciting, and older sister is reciting, and everybody is reciting, and because I am little, I don't know how to recite, that is why they are all helping me to learn and then finally join them. So now he or she can understand, feels motivated that I will be part of this group. But when nobody is reciting, why me at the age 4 or 5 or 6 is being pushed, learn and recite? So my brothers and sisters, we need to create that environment and lead it. Now, time is almost up. Just a few masail. While we read the Quran, first of all, it is mandatory. It is the ayat of Quran that when you recite the Quran, first recite this ta'awwudh, which is say a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, and then of course bismillahir rahmanir rahim. So when we begin our tilawat, we should say a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, then bismillahir rahmanir rahim, and then of course we are going to recite. Before that, when we take Quran in our hand, we have to be tahir, we have to be clean, we have to be bawudu, we have to be bataharat. So we need to train ourselves and train our children that when they are going to read the Quran, they will make wudu. Only bawudu people will be able to touch the text of Quran. But holding the Quran like this, you don't need wudu. So bringing the copy from the shelf, giving to father, giving to mother, or putting Quran from one table to the other table, you don't have to have wudu. But if you open it, and if you are going to read it, and if you are going to touch it, then of course you have to have wudu. It is haram and it is sin to make Quran najis. So we have to be very careful that if there is any najasat around, then we need to make sure that we don't put Quran in a way that it becomes najis. Giving the Quran in the hands of very young child who doesn't know how to respect it, how to hold it, and the chances are that will make it najis or will disrespect it. So we shouldn't put the Quran on the access of that very young child. Quran, there is a question before that. When we take Quran, when we give Quran, when we put Quran, we are living in a different society where people are going to deal with Quran just like any other book. So books are sometimes thrown like that. Books are picked like that with one hand and given to each other in a way just like it is any other book. Quran is not like any other book. This is a book of Allah. Muslims all along in our history of 1400 years maintain the high respect for Quran. So it's good to hold it with two hands when we are giving to someone, when we are receiving from someone, instead of one hand like that. Don't put it on the floor just like it is almanac or it is just like any other dictionary or any other book, and put on the floor and people jumping up and down and sometimes crossing over. Sometime in Middle East you see those kind of things because it is in their own native tongue, Arabs, and to them little bit it's a easy thing. But that is not right. Even their ulama, they don't like that. So Quran should be always put little high on table. It should be put on the higher place. People shouldn't cross over. People shouldn't jump over. And when we give, it should be with respect. People ask this mas'ala, can we give Quran to non-Muslims? Non-Muslim friends, or there are some non-Muslims that who request the Quran, copy of Quran, can we give them? There are certain controversies on that, but the answer to this is that yes, if there is a genuine request, if there is somebody that who is a reasonable person and is has a genuine request, and you hope that he will take the Quran, he will read it, he will look into it, he is asking for good reasons, then yes, definitely you can give this copy of Quran to that non-Muslim. Ulama make ihtiyat, they say that it is good to give them the translation instead of the matn. But then if this non-Muslim is Arab, what you are going to do? The translation. So now of course you are going to give him the Quran. So it means that this translation is also a kind of meaning something which is secondary. Basically the answer is that yes, you can give the Quran to a non-Muslim if he has a genuine request and if he wants to read the Quran. While we are reciting Quran, there are certain places where we have sajda wajib. Four places in Quran, there are wajib sajdas. And when you read that ayat or when you listen that ayat and somebody is reciting, it is wajib to do sajda. So it's good to do sajda right away, but if you forgot, whenever you remember sajda, you have to do the sajda. For that sajda, it is good that you should do toward Qibla, but it is not mandatory. If people are sitting in Quran Khani or in a gathering and you are sitting in a certain direction, that people are sitting right and left and you cannot really now make this sajda toward Qibla, so any sajda to any direction will be okay when this is sajda of tilawat Quran. But if you can, then it is good to do toward Qibla. For this sajda of Quran, there is no need to say any Allahu Akbar, and no zikr is mandatory. Just sajda will suffice. You put your forehead on the ground and you make this sajda, that is fine. But then if you want to say, then there are azkar. La ilaha illallahu, ilahan, haqqan, haqqan, haqqa, and there are other other azkar also. But only just doing sajda will also suffice. But this is when you are reading or you are listening from somebody who is reciting. I hope that this discussion will give us some reasons that we should take this word of God from the shelves and from the tables into our hands. We begin reading this on daily basis. Take Quran as our companion, take Quran as our friend. According to the ahadith of Prophet and A'imma, Quran is one of those who will do shifaat inshallah at the day of judgment. And Prophet says shafi'un mushaffa, he is a shafi, yani someone that who will do shafaat, and his shafaat is accepted one also. So it's good to take Quran as a companion, as a shafi, as a shafaat, and rely on its shafaat and source of knowledge, source of spirit, source of inspiration, source of strength. And while we are teaching to our young ones, we the older ones have to first take the benefit of it. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He give us tawfiq, where we take this revelation and revealed word of God as very important message for us, and we read to it and we learn lessons from it and we live with it. Recite a louder salawat.